Hi everybody, I'm Becky Stern, the Director of Wearable Electronics at Adafruit, and today I'm doing an interview for Make Magazine Wearables Week. The community editor, Caleb Kraft, sent me some great questions, and we also have an article in the latest issue, so if you're curious, continue watching and I'll answer all of his questions. First up, he says, how have wearables changed since you got started? Maybe some quick background on what you studied in school. And I studied design and technology at Parsons School of Design right around the same time as the Arduino came out, so that was really fortunate for me. I did maybe one semester of PIC chip programming, and then it was on to Arduino, which was a lot easier to get started with for an art student like me. I made plush toys, like you see here is a toy that was a pair of dueling siblings, and when one of them was wearing the crown, a reed switch, magnetic reed switch, would light up the LEDs in its teeth. But we only had regular Arduino boards to work from, so all the wires are always hanging out, and of course they're just prototype student projects. But I did a lot with the Arduino right when it first came out, and I feel really lucky about that. And then I was also playing around with some weird conductive materials, but there weren't any instructions for any of this stuff about, you know, the best way to use it or cool projects to do. You just kind of had to make them up as you went along. So here's LED bike helmet. And as you can see here, another Arduino board hanging out of a textile project. My first article for Make was these plush illuminated stakes that I also made in school. But using some demo, it was just like the sample pulse width modulation code that came with Arduino. And if that wasn't there, I was stuck, you know, up basic stamp creek without a paddle. So that's really fortunate. At the same time, Craft magazine came out, and this is a project that was in the first issue by Leah Beakley, which is an electronic tank top with a sewable LED sequins, but you still had to use a giant AVR development board to program the chip. So that was a really inspirational project, but hard to get started building yourself. So she developed the LilyPad Arduino, which is, you know, takes the open source design of the Arduino and turns it into a sewable flat format that's easy to use with conductive thread. And there were fun tutorials for projects like this one, this LED turn signal hoodie. That was really inspirational for me, and because I was still embedding electronics into clothes like this. This is a TV Be Gone circuit, and you can see the wires are joined with conductive thread any way you can, but it's not a very natural connection. So you can see the pretty stark contrast between what Arduino board clones and derivatives and compatible devices were looking like, and then when the sewable one came out, what kind of world it opens up for all kinds of people who already had textiles on the mind. And I did a couple projects for Make with the lily pad that were really fun and got a lot of attention from textile enthusiasts. But basically, they became a lot easier to use, Arduinos and stuff like that. EL wire, I think, has remained similarly easy to use. This is 2007 Daft Punk costumes from their tour. And there was an instructable then, and there's instructables now. And EL wire, I feel like, has stayed the same usability for the last several years. But look at the microcontroller market now for wearables. So there's all kinds of boards available, even a .NET sewable microcontroller. So kind of mashing up like skills people previously had, if you're already into sewing, maybe this is your avenue into electronics. I just think now it's a lot easier and there are a lot more projects out there that hold your hand getting into wearable electronics. Okay, next question. What upcoming tech are you most excited about? That's fun. I'm always excited about everything that's coming out. But most notably, the Phona. It's a new Adafruit product that lets you put a cell phone inside your electronics project. So I'm looking forward to making a garment that, you know, like tweets when you fall in a puddle or calls your friend, you know, when you get out of the subway on your way to your favorite pub or it sends a text message for any reason. So I think the fact that you can get your hands on a cool GSM module that's so small is really neat, and I'm excited to see what people do with the Phona. The other tech I'm excited about that's happening recently is Bluetooth low energy. So that's the new standard that the new iPhones use, the new iPads, and it's Bluetooth has previously been pretty high power, so the new low energy chips are pretty exciting. Because they make it possible to put this tiny chip that can communicate with your phone inside your garments. This is the Shine activity monitor that uses Bluetooth low energy to communicate your activity stats to your phone. And we also have a Bluetooth low energy module that makes it so that you can use your phone to send a message to your LED scrolling hat things like that. So the idea that you can use your phone, like if your garment can't be a phone, which it almost can be so far, you can control it with your phone so that your dress changes color depending on the weather report that comes into your phone every day, stuff like that. I think the possibilities are really opening up. So phone wearables and Bluetooth low energy wearables are what I'm excited about. The next question is, what is the biggest bottleneck in wearables currently? And I don't know that there is one. I think that it's really taking off like crazy, and that's really exciting. Here's the our wearable electronics Pinterest board, and there are many out there, wearable tech Pinterest boards. You can spend all day on there looking at all of the cool projects that are going on. And here's Studio XO makes stuff for Lady Gaga and other stage performers. They're really taking off right now. And also Cute Circuit is a company that's also made costumes for celebrities, but also has their own line out this season of iPhone-controlled animated garments. So I'm seeing the space really take off. I don't think there is a bottleneck as far as what people can do. There's a lot of possibilities out there, and you're seeing a lot of startups take advantage of the sensors that are available and the fact that people want to put tech on the real estate of their body. So there's just endless dog activity monitor startups, hair clips that call the police when you're mugged, all kinds of businesses starting up right now. It's really sort of fervent activity. No bottleneck, I don't think so. The next question is, who are three people's work you enjoy watching? Well, besides all of the customers and other people on the internet who share their wearables projects, just individual people who've made their first project, those are really my favorite, when people are getting that first bit of inspiration and opening up the possibilities of what they can make in the future. Here are three people who are doing really awesome work right now. Moritz Waldemeyer makes costumes for all kinds of bands, OK Go, jackets, beautiful chandeliers, beautiful table sculptures, just amazing LED work overall. But he's not in the DIY space. He's doing corporate hotel lobbies and big events. He did Olympic opening ceremony dance costumes, but really high-level inspirational stuff. And then another guy I really like is Adam Harvey. He's doing all of this stealth wear, or like wearable tech that helps you fight against other technology. So like a cape that hides your thermal image from surveillance drones, and cell phone pockets that block your cell phone signal, or makeup that makes you invisible to facial recognition software. And I think that kind of stuff is really important because it teaches you, or he's making it fashionable to be aware of how technology works and how it might work against you, and how you can use technology to fight technology that you don't agree with, and in a really fun, fashionable way. He's also a nice guy. And then the third person whose work I'm really excited about watching now is Katia Vega. She does what she calls beauty technology, or like conductive makeup that controls all kinds of digital interfaces, RFID fingernail polish to unlock doors, and she documents it all, LED headdresses. She's involved in various events, and her work is really fun to follow online. So I really like anybody's work that's documented really well, so that I can see it and so they can see how it was made, and people who are clearly having a lot of fun doing what they're doing. Okay, the next question. As someone who does a million projects as part of her job, what wearables have made themselves part of your daily life? That's a hard question because I don't really wear a watch even. I don't like to wear stuff on my wrists. I wear a little bit of jewelry every once in a while, but it's all fashion related, so what goes with my outfit? But I would say if I had to pick some of the projects that I've done in the past, the one I wear most often is probably the TV Be Gone jacket. And originally it was a hoodie, and then I liked the way it functioned so much that I kind of wanted all my jackets to turn televisions off with the zipper. So I used a jacket that I really liked wearing already. And so now I just like wearing that jacket, and it just happens to come with this extra feature if that's the jacket I wear. So that's a big one, TV Be Gone, being able to turn TVs off with my zipper. It's been really handy throughout the years. And then I guess the project I wear most often, because we do a lot of costume stuff, we don't make fitness activity monitors that you're supposed to wear to sleep. This LED NeoPixel bangle bracelet I wear most often when I want to pick something from my catalog to dress up with. So those are my two favorites. There's one more question. Do more women and girls get into electronics that involve textiles and sewing? Well, maybe. But I have some things, some comments on the topic of the gender. Here is a couple of girls at the Google's Made with Code launch event. They're like doing this $50 million initiative to get girls into computer science because this, their studies are showing that the percentage of women in engineering and coding jobs is going way down over the last several years. And that's like not okay because it is really like if you don't know how to program, you will be programmed by the system. So, I mean, we like to make projects that have that are genderless and ones that are very specifically inspiring to groups of people. Because if you see something cool and you can see yourself wearing it, or you can see yourself making it, then that might inspire your imagination to build something else and to really see yourself as having a role in technology. So while a lot of projects are pretty genderless, like this EL Wire hoodie, which does involve some sewing, we also make projects that are specifically more feminine oriented. Just, I mean, there's like ladies adorn themselves, so there's like more fun opportunities like makeup, although this is costume makeup, so obviously for all genders too, but it does involve soldering. So, I mean, we do think about the audience when we make a project. This one lets you be a digital princess, and it does involve sewing or soldering. It's not a textiles project, but if a little girl sees a project that's very, very clearly a beautiful tiara and she wants to play dress up as a princess and wants her tiara to light up, it might inspire her to learn how to program and how to solder and sort of take what she knows and stretch the imagination a little. Also, like, I can't help but make projects that I would want to wear and I happen to be a woman. Similarly with this LED hair bow. It's just like, yeah, you've seen robot embroidery, but like to be really inspired in a sort of disadvantaged group, I don't know that they're disadvantaged, but you know, underrepresented, really speaks to that group. And because I do a project every week, I can do a project for girls, for boys, for everybody, depending on what week it is. And we do try to do projects that involve sewing and soldering and look good on a dude or a lady, like the Firewalker sneakers. And then here's a tie that it's an all sewing, all conductive thread project that, you know, is a necktie that typically worn by a dude. So we're trying to do the opposite too, like make engineering enthusiasts who maybe have never tried textile crafts before try that. So it works well for us if everybody wants to try the thing that they don't already know how to do, right? And to that end, we try to make projects with as broad of a reach as possible. So thanks, Caleb, for asking me all those great questions. And if you have any more questions for me, you can ask them in the comments or on Twitter, and I'll answer them on my live show, Wearable Electronics with Becky Stern, every Wednesday at 2 p.m. on the Adafruit YouTube channel. So thanks so much for the opportunity for being interviewed here on Make Wearables Week. It's very exciting, and I hope that you make something fun to wear.